What's up, you data friends? It's Yannis here and welcome to my channel. In this video, we're going to be discussing the differences between the data scientist role versus the data engineer role. Now, please note that I'm not actually a data engineer. However, because I work on a daily basis with data engineers, I have a very good understanding of what they do. Additionally, I will also be showing you some practical examples of these tasks so you get a better understanding of these two roles. Right, so I'm going to start with the data scientist and then I'm going to move to the data engineer. A data scientist analyzes data sets using a variety of tools and sophisticated techniques in order to solve business problems and generate actionable insights that will add value to the business and make an impact. So the idea is that the business will provide the data scientist with some data. The data scientist is going to use a variety of tools and sophisticated techniques in order to analyze that data and then go back to the business with actionable insights on how to improve decision making. However, before we get to the sophisticated fun stuff, which is basically the machine learning models, we have to go through the boring stuff. So the first thing I have here is that as a data scientist, you will be spending time either creating reports, refreshing them, or running them. And the kind of skills you need over here is data gathering skills, data cleaning skills, transformation skills, storing skills, and technical skills. So this is where SQL, Excel, database knowledge, and visualization tools knowledge comes into play. One example now we have here in SQL is that the business, let's say, is going to provide the data scientist with some data in Excel. The data scientist is going to come into the database, is going to input the data, create new tables if the data doesn't already exist in the database. Then the data scientist is going to write his queries, so clean the data, transform the data, aggregate the data in order to create a clean summary of that data. And then depending on the complexity, it's either going to move to Python for more advanced stuff, or it's going to go into Excel or a visualization tool so we can communicate our results with the business. So an example I have here is a dashboard in Excel, let's say. So we're going to be building this and providing it to the business. And another example is this dashboard I have in Power BI, which is connected into SQL. The next step now is analyzing the data. So after the data scientist finishes with creating or refreshing those reports, the data scientist is going to be spending time trying to analyze the data. So either looking for patterns into the actual reports. So for example, over here, trying to look into the reds and investigate why public sector is not meeting their targets, for example, or by running queries into SQL or in Python for more sophisticated queries like statistical analysis or machine learning models. So that's step two, which is analyzing the data. After the analysis now, the data scientist is going to have to communicate their results with the business. So the skills we need here is things like being able to write insights, storytelling, communication skills, critical thinking, and also strategic thinking. So they need to make sure that their analysis is aligned with the business's strategic objectives. Moving on, we have the ad hoc analytics. So usually these ad hocs, depending on complexity, are going to go to data analyst or data scientist. If this ad hoc, which is basically a business question derived from the back of a meeting you had or a presentation you had, if this question now is complex and it requires statistical analysis, it's going to go to the data scientist. If it's simple, it's going to go to the data analyst. An example of a simple ad hoc is this one over here in SQL. So which account is performing the best in terms of revenue, for example. So the data scientist can write a very quick SQL query to get it. And an example of a more complex ad hoc question is which variables are affecting revenue the most. So this question will need to go into Python, for example, and run feature importances in decision trees so you can see which variable affects revenue the most. Moving on, the next task we have under data scientist is automating all processes. So the idea is that any work that can be scheduled and automated should be scheduled and automated, so we save more time. One example I have over here is how we connect SQL with Python. So let's say we have to run a machine learning model every Monday, every week. So we can actually connect SQL with Python, as I show over here, run our model and then save our results back into SQL. Within SQL now, we can schedule this to run every Monday, and then we can connect this new table that we are creating, which is called GDP forecast output, into a new table in SQL, and then connect this table with Power BI, and then build a dashboard, publish the dashboard, schedule the dashboard to refresh every Monday, and there you go, you have a fully automated project running without any data scientist supervision. However, it's always worth checking the results for the first few weeks just to make sure the machine learning model is running as it should. Moving on, the next skill we have is communication skills. So I have a few examples here why a data scientist needs to have very good communication skills. So you might have done some analysis and you have to present your results to the entire business, or you might need some data that is not in the database and you have to go and talk to people in order to find out from where to get that data, or you might have been tasked to help the team, let's say the marketing team, and analyze their performance. So you need to go there, sit down, speak with them, try to find out what's their problem, try to find the data that's going to help you solve that problem, and then use that data to solve the problem, and then communicate your results back to them. So it's a constant back and forth when it comes to solving these data problems. The next step we have now, which is the favorite from the data scientist, is the building the machine learning models. So data scientists need machine learning knowledge. So models like linear regression, logistic regression, naive Bayes, decision trees, etc., etc. Additionally, data scientists will need knowledge of Python or R. Next, we have statistics, and at the end, we have some advanced machine learning libraries. So an example of a machine learning model, if we go over here into Python, here we have three machine learning models. So we have a decision tree, which is this one over here. Where is it? Running a decision tree. Down here we have a random forest model, and down here we have XGBoost model. Then once we are happy with our model, we deploy our new model on unseen data. So we're going to be feeding this model with new data from SQL. We're going to be saving our output back into SQL in a new table. We're going to be connecting that new table, which is going to be in the database, with a visualization tool, which in our case is Power BI. So this one over here. We're going to be building our dashboard. So in our case, we are predicting the churns from a bank. So we can see we have 472 predicted churns. And as a data analyst, you will need to help the business identify who these people are, what influences them churning, and how you can stop these people from churning. So this is one example of how a data scientist can use machine learning in order to help the business. Now, the next two things we have is critical thinking and creativity. So critical thinking is when the data scientist will need to challenge their own presuppositions. So they need to ask themselves questions like, am I doing this wrong? Am I thinking clear? Am I doing this right? Is there another way of doing it? A better way, a faster way, more efficient way, a cheaper way? Why this way over this way? Why this person is asking this question? Are there any hidden reasons, etc., etc.? So the data scientists will need to be critical on their solution. And creativity over here is because no problem is ever going to be the same. So the data scientists can get creative on the kind of model or software they're going to use for their analysis, or they can get creative when designing these dashboards, or they can get creative into including more data in order to enhance their analysis. They can also get creative on storytelling. And lastly, they can also get creative when it comes to automating their work. Down here, we have the typical workflow, but we are not going to go over this right now. So this is a short summary of what a data scientist does. Now, a data engineer is responsible for creating and managing systems, databases, and pipelines in order to provide an automated and secure data environment for the business to use. So the idea is that the data engineer is responsible for all the systems and databases of the whole organization. To break this down now, the first thing we have is database and systems creation and management. So as a data engineer, you will be spending time creating new databases and new systems based on the project requirements. So skills like database and server creation skills, database and server management skills, data gathering and cleaning skills, data investigation and data analysis skills, data transformation and storing skills, automation skills, and of course, technical skills. Now, technical skills are dependent on the tech stack of the company you're going to be working with, but mostly here we have SQL Server, TSQL, Excel, SSRS, dimensional data modeling, data warehouse, cloud tools, and also any other tech the company has. One example now is in SQL over here, we have one server, one database, and five tables. In a data engineer world, they're going to be multiple servers, multiple databases, and multiple tables. So the engineer is going to be responsible for managing all these servers, databases, and tables, which is basically what's holding the raw data. Now, moving on the second step, we have data retrieval from a number of sources. So after you have your databases and systems in place, you will be spending time connecting to a number of data sources and pulling in the required data. Now, this is very important for data engineers, and this is why we have this data pipeline responsibilities picture I took from Google. So this is not my work. So over here, we can see all the data producers. So the data engineer is going to be tabbing into all of these sources over here, connecting them with the database, the main database, which is this one over here. So the engineer is going to be responsible into writing code that gets the data from one place and puts the data in another place. Also, within that code, there are going to be transformations and aggregations, as most probably the raw data coming in will need to be reshaped or aggregated in different ways. And just to show a practical example of this data retrieval, let's say the business asks the engineer to pull data from Social Blade into our main database. So Social Blade is actually social data. So the data engineer will need to go into Google, type in Social Blade API just to check if there is an API, and then start investigating if there is actually an API. As we can see down here, there is an API and they give you the code. So the engineer is going to have to do two things. First, they're going to need to go through documentation of the actual API and figure out if the data requested from the business actually exists into this API. The second thing the engineer is going to have to do is investigate or calculate how much money this API, so this data pool, is actually going to cost the business, because the business might turn back and say, look, it's too expensive, we don't want it. So let's say the business goes through with this API, then the data engineer is going to have to come here, take the code, adjust the code to only pull the KPIs that are requested from the business, and then store the data back into the main database. Hopefully this gives you an idea of what an API call is and how engineers are using it. Looking at the skills now, we have API calls here, FTPs, pipeline creations, ETL and ELT processes, And the last thing we have are technical skills. Again, these are dependent from the actual API, so third-party businesses, because some companies have their APIs on Python, some on C, some on Java, some on multiple languages, so it depends. Right, moving on to the next task now is dimensional data modeling. So after the engineer finishes pulling in all the data and storing the data, then the engineer will be spending time building dimensional model based on business requirements. And just to show you an example of the model, if I go over here, so this is actually Power BI, but it does let me see the model. So this is the model. We have our fact table and then our dimensions over here. So four dimensions. The idea is that the engineer, after pulling in the data, is going to be storing the data in a way into facts and dimensions that make sense for the business. So there might be some data splitting, so selecting all the accounts, for example, and putting them into one dimension, selecting all the stores and putting them into another dimension, selecting all the managers in another dimension. And as far as I understand it, there is three reasons why we do that. The first one is so that we can enable the business to self-serve, so they can actually connect into the data model and drag and drop and play with the data themselves without having the data scientist or the data analyst doing this for them. The second reason is because of security. So with this way, you can control who can see what from each fact or dimension. And the third reason is that when it comes to big data, or when it comes to live data, dimensional models perform a lot better versus having to load all the data within the application itself. Right, going back here now, the next task we have for data engineers is data security. So when you have a final product, you will need to ensure that all data and processes have been set up securely. So data security processes knowledge is one skill that you need as a data engineer. And the other thing you need to do is that you need to ensure that you follow data security protocols. For example, no PI data in your final outputs or no security breaches when moving data around. So as I have explained before, when it comes into the data models, data engineers will need to give specific access into like a few people into this table or a few other people into this table, so the engineers can control who gets to see what. Right, moving on, we have data migration. So most companies move their on-prem solutions to cloud solutions. Chances are that you will have to do some work on data migration. So it's widely known that all companies now are moving that data from their on-prem servers into the cloud. So AWS or Azure or GCP. So as a data engineer, most probably you will have to get involved too into moving, let's say, the SQL scripts or the stored procedures into the cloud. And in terms of the programming language, it doesn't have to be the same necessarily. So you might be moving from SQL into Python, for example. So you will need to translate all the SQL code, the stored procedure, into Python or vice versa, or with different languages. Right, the last thing we have is cloud solutions. So as we said before, most of the companies, if not all, are moving from on-prem into cloud technologies. And those cloud technologies are Azure, AWS, or GCP mostly. Right, so the skills you need here, as we said, is you'll need to know this one of these three tools. You don't have to know all of them. You will need to know how to use cluster technologies, so how to spin up a cluster, what CPU power to select, what RAM, which is memory, if you need to attach a GPU or not. You're going to need to know how to optimize your cluster. So let's say maybe your cluster is costing you a lot and it's not being used all the time, or maybe your cluster needs more power. So you will need to adjust that cluster. The other thing we have over here is distributed technologies. So nowadays you have tools like Snowflake or Databricks or BigQuery or Redshift that are actually running all your queries on distributed machines. So that helps you minimize the time it takes to run your code. Right, so I hope this is a good enough summary of what a data engineer is doing. Now, data scientists and data engineers are actually interacting a lot together, and I know this from personal experience, almost on a daily basis. The reason why is because on most occasions, data scientists will know the business requirements better than the data engineers. So the data scientists will need to explain to the data engineers how they want their raw data, in which format, and where they need to store it, so the data scientists can then go and tap into that clean data that the data engineer provided and run their machine learning models. Another thing I've done over here is that I have taken all these tasks from both jobs and then I have plotted them into this Power BI dashboard so we can put them next to each other and compare. So as you can see over here, data scientist, which is this orange over here, is mostly doing presentation of results, machine learning models, critical thinking, creativity, communication with the stakeholders, analyzing the data and ad hoc analytics. And then the data engineer now is mostly doing dimensional modeling, database management, data security, data pipelines, automating all processes, and also cloud technologies. Now, I have also done the same with the technologies, but please bear in mind that technologies are dependent from the company and the tech stack that the company has. So this is an idea of my personal experience. So over here we have data engineers using mostly Snowflake, SQL, C, Java, Scala, and other for API calls, cloud technologies, and the clusters. And then data scientists are using mostly Python, PowerPoint, Power BI, or Tableau, which is data visualization, Excel, but also SQL. There is a lot of SQL. And slowly, slowly, data scientists are starting to use Snowflake, BigQuery, or Redshift. Right, this is it for this video. I hope you've gained a good understanding of the differences between a data scientist and a data engineer, and also how they can work together. If you feel that you've gained enough value out of this video, I would really appreciate it if you click the like button, subscribe to my channel, and enable notifications for my future videos. Thank you very much for watching this video.